Hello everyone. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you to the VIP programme for Collect 2021, the International Art Fair for Contemporary Craft and Design. Supported by Loewe and Cox London, I'm delighted to be broadcasting the VIP programme from the new Crafts Council Gallery, which is, we hope, will be open soon. And it's great to be doing it not behind a laptop. I'm surrounded by the most beautiful pieces of contemporary craft from the galleries, some of the galleries we have at this year's fair, as well as it being dressed by the beautiful furniture loaned to us by Cox London. So, what is the hottest contemporary craft to be investing in? For this online version of the fair, we are running a series of special VIP events called Collect Selects, each focusing on the different materials that are used in contemporary craft. There will be a Q&A at the end that I will help to monitor, and at the bottom of your screens you'll see a little Q&A, so do put your questions in there. So this is Collect Selects number 4, wood, paper and larger scale works, and this is in association with Interior Style Hunter. So today we'll be discussing wood and paper, and our supporting partner for this talk is the wonderful Grant Pierrus and his Interior Style Hunter, and he's joined by 3 other experts. So we have Hugo Burge. Very warm welcome to you, Hugo, director of Marchmont House, which is an amazing place up on the Scottish borders. We have Nicky Dobree, who is a very respected interior designer. And we have Sarah Myerscough, who's founder of the Sarah Myerscough Gallery, one of our longest serving galleries at Collect, who has an incredible knowledge of wood and will be sharing a lot of her artists with us today. And of course, then we have Grant. And I'll let Grant introduce the others a little bit more to you, but Grant has an incredible network of interior designers, architects, suppliers, artists and makers. He writes a regular blog which has over 40,000 readers. And building, he loves to build on a strong design community, and what drives his Interior Style Hunter and his various business interests. And he collaborates in a huge amount with interior designers and luxury brands. So Grant, I will let you set the scene with the others, and we are really looking forward to hearing your views on these beautiful pieces of work we're about to see. Thank you.
Lovely. Well, thank you for the introduction, Isabel. It's certainly lovely to be here today, and I'm so looking forward to this discussion. As I've said many times before, Collect is one of my favorite shows, and I adore just being part of this. So that's just so wonderful and brilliant for me. Together with our guests on the panel today, we're going to be discussing our love of artists who work in wood and related materials. And this is going to be highlighted by a selection of works that are available at the fair, and including works from Sarah's Collect selection, Broken Beauty. And we're going to be looking through those pieces, sharing some videos with you, and layering a discussion around those pieces. So we'll get going with that soon. But let me first introduce all the speakers in a little bit more detail. So firstly, Hugo. So Hugo is the director of Marchmont, and with a dream to establish a home to makers and creators, and nurturing the restoration of an estate with the purpose of inspiring creativity in the arts, crafts, and business and social enterprise. I've had a look through Hugo's work, and it's phenomenal to see how Hugo is supporting makers, hosting makers, and working with makers at Marchmont House to develop the craft sector. Hugo, is there anything you would like to add to that?
Thank you, just beaming in. No, just delighted to be here. And I've enjoyed Collect myself, and certainly have a great enthusiasm for wood and this whole area. So thank you very much for having me. I'm looking forward to it.
Super. Next up, we have Nicky Dobree. And I've known Nicky for quite a few years and adore Nicky's interiors. And Nicky's an award-winning interior designer who creates elegant and timeless interiors that are each an expression of the client's style. It's our belief that private homes influence the way that we feel, and by changing your surroundings, we can change your lives too. And if ever I have a beautiful chalet, Nikki's the designer that would be doing that for me. Nikki is just a phenomenal designer. Nikki, is there anything you would like to add to that intro?
Well, like Hugo, thank you very much for having me and for inviting me on this discussion. As you say, Grant, I'm very much looking forward to partaking yet again and sharing a discussion with you.
Lovely. And last introduction is Sarah Myerscough. And Sarah is the founder of her gallery in her own name, and she represents a distinguished group of contemporary craft and design artists specializing in material-led processes with a focus on wood. The gallery works in both public and private collections and maintains a full program of exhibitions and participates in leading art fairs around the world, like she is today. And I've also known Sarah for quite a few years, and Sarah's gallery is just around the corner from my home. So it's always wonderful to drive past and see new pieces in the window. Sarah, would you like to add anything to that?
Yes, that's a lovely introduction. Thank you, Grant. And I'm really delighted to be talking on the subject. So looking forward to that.
Brilliant. So just to kick us off, before we start looking at any of the pieces, you know, we're talking about wood and related materials in today's talk. So tell me about each of your interests in wood, and where does, you know, art or crafted wood sit in the collectibles or art sector? Sarah, would you like to start?
Yes, of course. So I started dealing in wood about 15 years ago. I was introduced to the material through collectors, actually. They had a wonderful collection of turned wood art. And I was really inspired by that collection. It was mostly from American makers, beautifully tactile, very sensory pieces. And I'd always had an emotional connection to art. So that was the starting point where I really kind of fell in love with the material, I guess. I think it's interesting for me showing them at Collect because I've watched how they've been admired, and the value has increased, and the perception of wood in the craft sector has increased too.
And just touching on that, Sarah, you know, the perceived value of wood in the craft and art sector. You know, ceramics is generally championed as the most valuable and most sort of sought after as a collectible. But how is wood changing, and what are you doing to help change the perceived value of that, of wood?
I think it's obviously quite new to this country, wood as a serious craft process. And so I think that when it came over from America, when I introduced it about 15 years ago, it was, yes, I think it was very difficult for people to understand. So putting in the context of Collect next to these wonderful ceramic pieces, I think people started to see the correlation and understand the material value. And I think also when the V&A started buying wood, the first piece they ever bought from me was an Ernst Gampel, the German artist. And that was a real triumph because I think it was the first piece of objet d'art that had been made from turned wood.
All right. And Nikki, I mean, using wood in your projects, you know, what is your personal interest in wood collected craft pieces?
Well, as you know, I'm passionate about wood. I build and design in timber all the time. But I think, you know, what's particularly interesting, you know, today is the timing of the collection, is I think, you know, as we sort of look at the fragility of the world in which we're in, you know, we become ever increasingly desperate to reconnect with nature. So, and I think wood has this wonderful way of connecting you to nature, and through the buildings that I design, obviously, and using timber within my buildings, you know, we are connecting back to nature, and we're connecting back to a very ancient craft form as well. We've been building in timber for centuries. And I think, you know, that's very, you know, that's very apparent as well through, you know, the objects that we're seeing in Collect and the material and how they're, you know, they're referencing back as well to these wonderful, you know, original pieces. But I think above all, for me, it's, I mean, unlike clay, you know, wood is an organic material, so it's alive. And, you know, all these wonderful artists are therefore creating pieces that are alive and living. And, you know, so you're really feeling that. You're really feeling this emotional connection to the pieces, just as you're feeling an emotional connection within a timber interior that you're living in. So I think, you know, the wood has an enormous value for that very reason.
Okay, and a little bit later on in the talk, we'll discuss layering wood and how you in particular, you know, thinking of how you use wood in the interior, you know, as the fibre of the building and then sort of layering it on with collectible pieces towards the end. So I'm looking forward to uncovering that a bit later. And Hugo, tell me about your interest in wood and collecting pieces, as well as supporting artists who create in wood.
Sure. Well, from a very young age, I think I had a soft spot for wood. But I think the moment I fell in love with wood was the time I spent in the Beadells Library, which is one of the finest arts and crafts buildings in the country. I think I was very spoilt and lucky to go there, and I acknowledge that. But it is an exquisite cocooning building made of incredible beams of wood, and I fell in love with it. It's a place where I feel cozy and comfortable and relaxed, and I think that kind of soulful attachment happened. It was very personally lucky to have an incredible woodwork teacher who I think brought wood alive in my imagination, and I felt the magic of wood and the individuality of wood. No grain is the same. No piece of wood is the same. It has real character and it has soul. And so I think I've had an intrinsic love of it. And when I came to be involved in this project to restore Marchmont, it felt very natural to me. I would just fall in love with pieces made of wood. And I think it was really that simple. I also had a particular passion for the arts and crafts rush seat chair, which was again in the Beadells Library, but is a very humble symbol of the arts and crafts movement. So I've devoted a lot of time. I'll try not to talk too much about it because I get a bit overexcited, but I have been supporting apprentices to make rush seat chairs. And that is an incredibly organic and natural process, cutting down rushes in a river. But I think then you asked the question, how else are we supporting artists? Well, what for me I love about artists and makers' connections with wood is the stories and the way in which different people interact with wood and bring it alive and make things that are beautiful. So it's more than just a visceral aesthetic appeal. You start to understand how it was made. And once you come to understand how it's made, that has a special place in your heart. So for me, bringing together pieces made of wood has been an important part of restoring Marchmont, things with stories, things with soul, things that I feel comfortable with and make me feel comfortable and make me feel also a connection with nature. I thought what Nicky was saying about a connection with nature is really, really powerful. I'll just dart back to the Beadells Library. The Beadells Library was designed by Ernest Jimpson and is a symbol of the arts and crafts movement. Now, we have to remember the arts and crafts movement was a reaction against the Industrial Revolution. It was a celebration of craftsmanship, of the handmade materials, of that making process, of individuality. And I think I come from a tech background. I'm a recovering tech entrepreneur in many ways. And I'm itching for a reconnection with nature and with the handmade. And so wood for me really does that in spades. So I think that's probably why wood feels important today.
Yeah, brilliant. Well, we've got some phenomenal pieces that Sarah's going to give us a brief synopsis on. We're going to start the slideshow if we could. And Sarah, could you just give us, you know, a couple of lines about some of these pieces? And I'm going to chime in and add some questions. And if Nicky and Hugo want to sort of just add in any sort of feelings they have, I know you've chosen some of your favorites, which are among some of these pieces as well. So when those pop up, if we could just start discussing that. So let's go. Sarah, do you want to tell us about this piece by Jane Ponsford?
Yes, this is a beautiful stack of handmade paper by Jane Ponsford. It's made from 400 from dyed paper, which is an old process of making from iron and oak. So she's dyed the paper and then she stacked it, so it's very crisp, a fragile, and has a lot of textural interest.
Great. Can we just flip to the next slide, because we've got two images of this?
Yeah, then you can get a real sense of the surface quality of these. I think they're wonderful, very sensory pieces.
And so a question I want to sort of pose to the audience is, you know, a show like Collect, you know, do you look to Collect to explore new materials, new pieces, new makers? Do you look to Collect to help give you a benchmark of works that you can collect? You know, what do you actually, how do you use Collect and these pieces together? How do they come together for each of you?
Shall I dive in?
For us?
Yep.
Yes, Hugo, you go forward.
Okay, I'll dive in. For me, it's quite simple. When I've wandered around Collect, it's really been a source of inspiration. I remember stumbling across Sarah's incredible stand at Collect when I visited and was just blown away by the variety of just sheer beauty. So for me, it's serendipitous, it's inspiring, and I don't really go there with anything in particular in mind. I think it's about stumbling across things that you fall in love with.
Okay.
I mean, I couldn't agree more, Hugo. I mean, when I was in Sarah's gallery the other day, you instantly have this emotional connection to the pieces. They evoke an emotional response. And I think that's what's extraordinary about them. So you touch on them at an initial level. And then when you hear the story behind them, you look at them in greater detail. And then you get a much better understanding of that piece. But it is all about the connection to a timber piece. And I think that is what makes it so very, very special.
Exactly. I was in Sarah's gallery a couple of months ago, I think just before November or so, and, you know, just exploring some of those pieces. It was a sort of show about all natural materials, and it was just, there was something about it that evokes exactly what both Hugo and Nicky are saying, this connection to the natural world, which is really powerful. And then you start to understand how the makers and craftsmen are creating. I mean, it's pretty amazing. Can we flip to the next slide? Yes, okay. There we go. Sarah, do you want to just tell us a little bit more about this?
Yes, of course. This is a project between Addy Tok, who's a silversmith, and Jim Partridge, who works in wood. He actually works in quite monumental furniture pieces, but these are small handcrafted pieces, and it was a real connection between the two of them when they were both selected for the Loewe Craft Prize. So it's quite instinctual the way they make these pieces. So he carves this very sort of strong dynamic wood piece, and then Addy pours in molten silver into the cracks. So all the lovely imperfections in the material, the silver explores the surface and leaves this lovely burnt surface with a little glimpse of the gorgeous material, the silver inside. So it's very revealing, and it just shows how materials work together, how makers work together. It's a lovely connection.
Well, it's not very often that you see collaborations in the craft world, sort of, you know, two different skills coming together with different materials like this. So that, I find that fascinating, actually.
Yeah, it is. It's a really interesting, exciting area of craft. A lot more artists are coming together using their sort of innovative skills in terms of process and the very differing types of material and how those materials connect. I think we should see more of that in the future, I think.
I might just chip in here, one comment. It might sound a little bit weird, but reverting back to the question before about what you get from Collect, I love all the different textures and pattern on things, and there are surprises everywhere. And I think this is probably a good example. I feel myself wanting to peer into the cracks and sort of want to touch it and sort of see what's going on. But I think there's a sense of intrigue. They're very beautiful.
Yeah, I think so. And you can see a glimpse of the silver coming through the crack halfway down, so that you can imagine the silver finding its own path through the material, which is really beautiful. Very subtle, yes. Not showy. And also it's also about, because they have their own very own distinct practices. So it's something that they've made together. So they've used that collaborative process to find new forms, which is really exciting.
So just thinking about, you know, a question for all of you, you know, and we've sort of touched on this, but I want to deep dive a little bit further into it and thinking about what actually attracts you to collect, use and represent wood artists. And I think, you know, we've touched on this sort of the feeling of connecting back to nature. But is there anything broader than that for any of you?
Well, maybe I should. Yeah, oh, God, sorry, Nicky.
No, you go, Sarah.
No, I was just going to say, I think what's really important for me about wood now more than ever is, and I think Nicky and Hugo both mentioned that it's a real connection to the natural world. And I think that if art has value, it speaks of societal concerns, concerns over the environment. So I think these pieces will tell future generations how we started to care again for the world, how we started to respect the natural world. So that's really an important message in these art crafted pieces.
Absolutely. And I think also to Hugo's point, you know, it's a reaction against all the mass, you know, the technical side and the mass production. You know, this is all about creating unique individual pieces. You know, it's about having an object within your home that is unique and individual, and mm-hmm. and it's also organic, so it's ever changing and ever moving, because obviously timber cracks and moves as well. So, you know, these forms are very powerful, and they're living, and they you know, that they're breathing an emotive sense, you know, all the time. So I think that's really, and no one else will have a piece that is the same anywhere. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, this whole rebellion, if you like, against mass production is and as you say, Sarah, is just such a reflection of where we are today, and what it's an expression of today.
So this piece is fascinating. I mean, Sarah, could you tell us a little bit more about this piece?
Yes, it's Marlene Rissou, who's a French artist, and she works with silkworm cocoons. She works with wax from the hives. She her whole family were beekeepers, so she's very connected to the natural world. This is a quite unique, because it's one of the only pieces she's ever made in wood. It's very sculptural again. It has that sort of biomorphic form, and the surface is incredible. She's slowly, painstakingly gone over the surface and just scorched these tiny little holes. So it has a real personality and character, I find.
Yes, it's a lovely piece. It's a really, and all of you have chosen that as one of your favorites, which is quite interesting. So I have a question, which I really want to direct at Nicky, actually. I'm really interested in this answer. And, you know, it's all about layers of wood. So layering wood into an interior, thinking of the fabric of the building, the, you know, the sort of fixtures and fittings of the building, the furniture, and layering on collectible works at the end. Can you talk us through how you work with wood?
Well, I think, you know, it starts obviously in the case of Rochelle, it starts in the building itself. You know, it's essence, it's the essence of the structure, and it's the essence of the place. And it, you know, we're often working obviously in the local vernacular. So it's about, you know, making a home feel as if it belongs. It's a sense of authenticity and a sense of place. So that within the building is everything on the exterior, and then feeling that on the interior. So when you're using timber on the interior, of course, it's very dependent on the type of timber that you use, will have an impact on the feeling of the space. But walking into a timbered interior is a very special feel, and it's a unique feeling too, because every timber structure is different too, just as, you know, these pieces and these forms are very different, each and every one. Your timber interior is unique too. And I think, you know, we then obviously, you know, we also work with furnishings that are in furniture that's in timber, but then, you know, the final pieces, as you say, are these exquisite objects that, you know, are become their art, and they are the final layering of a home to make it special.
And it's what I'm really interested in is that dialogue between those different disciplines using the same material, but each being so functional in different ways. How do you create a dialogue that works between those different layers?
Well, I think, again, it comes down to the different types of timber that you're using for each setting. So, you know, the timber that you're going to be using to build your building, it is, whilst it may well be an oak, it's going to be treated in a very different way to the for the building structure than it is to, say, your oak kitchen table, or for example, or, you know, whether then you move it in, you know, see it in a structural sculptural form. So I think the ability, wood is such a versatile material, so there are so many different techniques that can be applied to it, as we're seeing from all these fabulous craftsmen who are using it. And that's the same within an interior too, you know, the techniques that people are using to put these buildings together and build these pieces of furniture are, you know, they're centuries old, but each and every one is unique. It's different. It's a skill set by an individual craftsman. And I think it's the different timbers, the different textures, the different layers, which ultimately all create the home that it finally ends up being.
And Hugo, from a restoration perspective. Karen.
Well, I was going to say, I think it sort of varies from room to room and building to building for me. Sometimes it's very much about being in keeping and blending in and making things make sense and complementary. But actually, I've found the most exciting places to have wood is actually more of a provocation as something standing out as a sort of, oh, a bit of a surprise. So when we put our David Nash three knobbers into the entrance hall here, it's really sitting in quite a traditional neoclassical entrance hall, but providing something that gives a little bit of, hopefully a little bit of wow factor, a little bit of, oh, what's going on here factor. And I think wood provides that in spades, and its natural forms, it's organic, it's curving, often very tactile, kind of the opposite of cold, formal spaces. So for me, I think it can either be complementary or it can be a little bit of a wild card, which provides a bit of excitement and shakes things up a little bit. And I've had fun doing that. I enjoy that bit.
Brilliant. Great. Yes, let's move on. Sarah, do you want to tell us about this Eleanor Lakeland piece, please?
Yes, this is a horse chestnut burl. So it comes when a tree has been knocked or something has hurt the surface, and the nodules grow around in this circular form to protect the wood. So Eleanor likes to reveal that element of distress, if you like. And so you can see that in the surface here, where she's actually handpicked off the bark from the nodules to reveal the underbelly of the wood, which has this kind of feeling of almost like porcelain or ceramic in some way. So there's a kind of real ambiguity of material. And here she is actually with the piece on the lathe, cutting away into the surface. And you can see how intricate the process is. I mean, for a woman working in wood, it's quite a physically demanding process. So, you know, it's technically challenging. And here she's also just blowing out all the dust. And this is, again, the turning process. These are great big chunks of wood that she has to bring down into small manageable pieces. And it's a very involved process. And then she uses this bleaching solution to create these lighter, softer surfaces, but they're hugely organic, wonderfully tactile. Incredibly emotive works.
Can we move to the next slide, please?
Max. So Max Brossi is another artist turning in wood. He's an Irish artist. And these are incredibly skilled pieces, because if you imagine you have a great big log that you have to turn on the outside. So this wood is rotating at a vast speeds. You're cutting away at the surface. And then you have to have much more intricate pieces of tools that will then cut away in the interior. So it creates a very, very thin line of wood That runs through the piece, as you can see there, and then he hand carves the surface. It's wonderful, this piece, because again it has an ambiguity of a material. You think maybe it's a metal or something, but it's actually a beautiful piece of sycamore which has been blackened.
And a question for you. So, you know, relationships between gallery designer and a collector or a purchaser, you know, I'd like to discuss that a little bit, and how, you know, how do you each sort of support, use each other in that network to find works, acquire works, you know, appreciate works?
Well, I think for me, actually, you know, it's, I mean, we're always being educated. You know, Sarah's a wonderful educator of what the pieces are. And as I say, you know, going to see Sarah and, you know, understanding the stories and sort of and being introduced to new pieces of work is a wonderful thing. And it's only through us being able to, you know, express an emotion, you know, if we like something, to be able to introduce it then to our clients or suggest it. If you don't know about it, you haven't got a chance to be able to do that. So it's lovely, you know, it's been wonderful sort of learning more about these artists that are coming forward. And I think it is all about educating so that you can introduce and spread the word.
And you, Hugo, I mean, you're quite active on different levels with this. You're working with younger, newer makers on different projects, but you're also supporting galleries, you know, that show at Collect, for example. I mean, what is your sort of overview of the sort of relationship between gallery, dealer, collector?
That's a good question. I don't think I'd really ever contemplated it in a very serious way, but I think I could probably, if I tried to articulate, I think I'd just say, when you're doing something up or when I'm involved in a project, I'm just foraging for stories. And sometimes those stories are told directly by makers, and sometimes they're told better and very professionally and emotionally engagingly by galleries. Or on Instagram, there are people who are very good at collating things. So I think when you've got your antennae up, you're just looking for stories. So I don't really think about it, but I think it's a great ecosystem, and there's kind of no rule. Sometimes there's a wonderful thing about meeting makers and hearing them tell their story, but sometimes there's a third party who's better at telling their story and getting their message across, or is in the right place at the right time for you to see something. So I think I'm just very versatile, really. I don't really think about it too much, I have to say.
Okay. Sarah?
No, I was just going to say, I think it really is important for the maker to have a very strong connection with the gallery as well, because it allows them to spend all their time in the studio, so they know that the gallery is supporting their practice through strong marketing, making sure the work is very visible to collectors and dealer interior designers, so that they're constantly feeding information and giving the stories that Hugo's talking about, those narratives that are so important, because our role as a gallery is to support artist makers and to have that dialogue with them, to tell them about how people are responding to their work. So they really appreciate that support as well. Yeah.
Brilliant. Can you, so Mark, I've known about Mark's work for, gosh, about 4 or 5 years. A friend of mine, Rachel Lacquer, has a couple of his works.
Oh,
and
yes.
Bought some works for her clients. And, you know, whenever I walk into her home, she has a large black one in her hall. And it's just the most phenomenal piece. And I absolutely adore it. So that's how I found out about Mark, and then sort of met Sarah. And what's interesting with Mark, I mean, the value of his work has just increased quite a lot over the last few years. I mean, he's just become so highly collectible. And his work is just so beautiful. And Sarah, could you just tell us a little bit more about him?
Yes, of course. So he's a French artist, and he turns and he works in Dijon. He's in a very sort of wooded area, and he's quite a hermit. So he spends most of his time kind of foraging for the wood, finding fallen wood pieces. It's important to note that all the artists that we work with in wood look at sustainable forests, or they work with wood that has already fallen. So that's an important note to make. But he is he's in his studio with these found woods that he drags from the forest and turns them on the lathe again, the same process, this old process of making. And then he turns them, then once he's turned them into their rough forms, he then carves intricately into the surface with these beautiful pieces. What's wonderful about his work is the different surfaces that he adds. So this is a ferrous oxide that he puts onto the top of a wood, which gives that wonderful metallic, really rich ochre colour.
Hugo and Nicky, I mean, I know some of these are your favourites, so some of your favourite pieces too from the fair this year. Do you have any comments on any of these?
Well, I was just going to go back to this one, which I just think is absolutely exquisite. I mean, I think the fragility of the fins that he's managed to create is extraordinary. And I just, you know, I love the sort of the pod-like feeling that comes, you know, from this form. But I think, you know, the delicacy of his work is just, I mean, outstanding, absolutely outstanding. And I think there's something, as you say, it's a very powerful piece and it's a very tactile piece. And I think it's got real presence. And, you know, Rachel did very well to buy one. I think it's got, you know, it's fabulous in an interior and unbelievably striking.
I think I would add that as well. It's just extraordinary. I remember seeing one on Sarah's stand at Collect when I came along and I was just mesmerized by them. I mean, they're just extraordinary, slightly nervous to touch it, but you, at the same time, you want to reach out and sort of try and understand it. But I loved hearing a bit more about Mark and how he makes them, actually. So again, immediately grabbed by the story as well, not just beautiful things.
Oh, wow, you got one, yeah.
I've just got one behind me, which is a lovely scorched piece. And you can see this is a found piece of wood. So you see where all the natural cracking has occurred, but it's you can see how finely it's turned on the inside. So wonderful, lovely organic shape, as Nicky said. It's great.
Lovely. Can we move on to the Nick Webb piece? We've only got two more pieces to go and then we're through.
So yes, this is Nick Webb, who's a British artist working on the South Coast. And he doesn't turn his work, interestingly, he carves the surface of the pieces. And they're found wood pieces. So he looks at the character of the material and then decides how he's going to work out the form. So it's about the actual piece of wood that's speaking to him. And so that's what creates these kind of, again, sort of slightly biomorphic forms. And there's different elements that he wants to focus on in the wood, the different cracks that he's interested in showcasing, or the different textural surfaces, the different patinas. So he's much more about highlighting the spirit or the soul of the wood that Hugo talked about. And then sometimes he'll burn the interior to create these hollowed out spaces inside.
And I think, I mean, this is obviously, we're seeing this live in the Collect studio at the moment, which is really wonderful to see.
Well,
beautiful piece.
I'll just say one thing. It's interesting. You talked about ceramics earlier. One of my favorite things in ceramics is this idea of wabi-sabi, the deliberate imperfections. But with wood, it's full of imperfections and beauty and eccentricities. And it's and in this example, they're being teased out in the extreme. And wood is wonderful because of that. You don't have to invent them. They're there and just being encouraged.
Yeah, he's quite physical and quite brutal with his wood. You know, he really, you know, goes at it hammer and tongue. And it's just, yeah, the smell of the burnt wood is ever present in the piece as well, which adds to the kind of sensory experience.
It's phenomenal to see. I mean, I'm so pleased we had
it's wonderful.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Gives you an insight into the materiality and the craftsmanship behind these pieces. It's just phenomenal.
Yeah, exactly.
But I love how, you
great
know,
fun as well.
Yeah, great fun.
Yes.
And
it's too
And the last piece that we've got here is actually something that I spotted when I was looking through the Collect pieces this year. And I mean, it's difficult to gauge what that is, but it's a piece that's made from twigs, wax, linen and twine. And it's really large and it hangs on a wall. And I wonder if we can cut to the the Collect gallery to see it hanging on the wall there. And I don't know, Isabel, could you stand next to it so we can just get a sense of scale? And it's being shown by Jagged Art, and it's by Kazuhito Takadoi. And it's just a beautiful, beautiful piece that just sort of caught my attention. And I think that's, you know, that's the whole joy of Collect, is to find new things, find new techniques, understand how these pieces are made, how these artists are creating using natural materials, which we're also passionate about on this panel. And so, yeah, I just wanted to share that piece with everybody to say, you know, that really wowed me with its scale and its intricacy and the materials used there. So I just really wanted to show that. But yeah, brilliant. This has been a really interesting talk. Does anyone have anything they want to sort of round up or finish on? Anything else they want to share before we head off to the Q&As? I think there might be a couple of questions.
I just wanted to just mention that also the idea of the Broken Beauty title for our showcase for Collect was really to highlight the role of the collector as a sort of custodian of pieces. They're sort of taking care of pieces rather than having these as commodities or throw away, in a sense that it's just passing on heirlooms, things for the future, things that people will remember us by, you know, as our legacy as humans in this kind of anthropic, you know, in these times.
Yes. So we've got a few questions here. One is Sarah's necklace made of wood?
No.
Another one.
No, it's actually stone and gold leaf.
Several mentions of the fragility of wood. How safe are these to have, for example, in a house where there's a chance they could fall or get knocked?
I think it's the same with any craft piece, to be honest. You obviously put pieces in safe places. I think they're less fragile than a ceramic or a glass piece, because if they do happen to drop, they're not necessarily going to break unless they're very fragile surfaces. It's how you look after them, and that harks back to the role of a collector. You have to look after these pieces.
Okay. And someone is asking about the collaboration, which we showed earlier between the wood and the silver maker. I think everything is on Artsy, so you can have a look on there or on the Collect Fair website or on Sarah's Instagram or Sarah's website as well. Right, so any final comments from you, Hugo?
That video.
I'd just say it's very exciting to see what seems to be a lot of innovation and experimentation with wood happening. If it wasn't in fashion and now it is, I mean, that's a great thing because I love seeing things made of wood. So from a selfish point of view, that's terrific.
Lovely. Thank you. And Nikki?
Well, I agree. And it's just wonderful to see how people are mixing these materials, you know, so it's not just the wood, it's also, you know, whether it's beeswax or the hemp or, you know, to create these exquisite pieces and using innovative techniques as well. I think it's absolutely fabulous. I mean, we've really, you know, this is the natural and contemporary aesthetic movement. And, you know, it's just wonderful to see such beautiful pieces coming through.
I completely agree. I'm very excited as well. It's such a beautiful material. And to see how these makers are creating contemporary pieces with it is just phenomenal. Sarah, last words? Mm-hmm.
Well, I just hope people will come and have a look at the pieces when we're open again, I guess.
Great.
Yeah, I think thank you all. That's been super interesting. I think what's so valuable about doing something like this is allowing people to understand more about wood and feel, as you say, Sarah, that kind of confidence in it and feeling that they are really beautiful pieces to live with and invest in as much as any other material. And I think if a collector or someone who, because I think so often when you may be wanting, because you know some pieces are of a price that you may feel I need to know more about this, then that's why Collect is so important when we work with the galleries. And it's the galleries, as you said before, who have that incredible connection with the artists and can help through that process so that you can really understand the stories behind them. Because Over 80% of the work in the fair is made in the last 5 years. So this is about living artists. This is about, you know, all the people you've spoken about today are all around, they're all alive, and are, you know, will work to commission and be able to do more work. So I think that collaboration and that connection between people like yourself, Nicky, and Hugh, the whole kind of ecosystem of how this all comes together, I think is so super important. And Grant, fantastic. Thank you so much for sharing this. And a really enjoyable talk. This is all being recorded, so people can come back and enjoy this at another time. But thank you all so much, and we'll see you again. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.